Hello, and welcome to this episode of Highlights from the Hill. I'm Jim Cousins, along with my co-host, Dr. Kathy McLeod.
Always a pleasure. Great to be back.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here, too. And this show is all about the high school. And we have with us Principal Mr. Bishop.
Thank you for having me.
So on our last episode, we've been going through all the schools, and we did the middle school last time. And now we're up to the high school with you. And on our last episode, we had a couple of kids who were doing a TV club, HMS TV, at the middle school. And we do something similar like that at the high school. So I was just wondering if you have any comments.
We do, yeah. It's HHS Today at the high school. It's a club that's been getting together for probably about a year and a half now. It's one of our more popular productions at the school. We put together a bi-weekly episode that we play during advisories on Thursday. So we send the link out to all students and staff, and then make it public on HCAM. And there's different segments from, they do a minute with me every episode, which I'm sure most people don't really care much about. But they also do a lot of segments with different clubs and organizations. They interview staff, highlight our international program, or the many different things that are going on at the high school. So it's been a really great addition to the things that are going on at the high school. Mm.
And you're very humble, but I happen to know for a fact we did get fan mail on the show that was missing your segment.
Yeah, I sent that mail in
for you. And the other thing I'm happy to, I just noticed the other day that on your website, on the high school's homepage, HHS Today is actually listed there.
It is. So it's one of the links on the left-hand side, which we're excited about.
I was very, very happy to see that.
Yeah, and we're hoping actually to continue to kind of grow it. Right now we have about 8 students that are part of the club. We know that there's more kids that want to get involved, but there's just so much going on after school. Mm-hmm. So we're considering kind of having one of our classes, one of our kind of filmmaking TV classes, really be geared more towards helping the HHS TV production for next school year. So we're excited about that.
Sounds cool.
Yeah.
All right, so let's talk a little bit about you and what's going on in your job there.
Sure.
Can I start this off?
Please.
Because last night, Evan and I were at a meeting together. We were at a community conversation. And I learned something that I didn't know about you last night, which is that you started your career here.
I did, yes.
In Hopkinton. And, you know, obviously you're a highly regarded and respected member of the admin team as well as of your building. But I thought that people watching would be interested to know that what you started doing here.
Yeah, sure.
And that you were right out of college, evidently.
I was, yes. I was right out of right out of grad school. I started here as a 24-year-old guidance counselor.
Wow.
At the high school. I spent 4 great years in the guidance department. I also coached a few sports when I was a guidance counselor. I helped out the football team and the baseball team.
Okay.
And then I became an assistant principal, first at an interim level, and then got the position for another 4 years, and then now I'm in my third or fourth year now as principal, which is really exciting. So
yeah,
only been in one place.
That's
so
great.
I have strong roots here. It's a community that I'm very passionate about, and I feel very at home. I mentioned last night it's a community that, you know, we're considering potentially moving to. There's other options out there, but it's certainly one of those communities that has such a great feel, great school system, and I'm just really excited to be a part of it.
Yeah, and I think that history in the school really shows, Evan, because you really understand, you know, the different departments when you talk about from athletics to guidance, and you've really grown with the school, and that really shows. So one of the things I wanted to ask you about is just what's unique about Hopkinton High School, and specifically, what are the things that you're really proud of that you can feel that you've been part of bringing into the school?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, what I'm probably most proud of, which is not something that I'm bringing into the school, is the students and some of the things that they're involved in. It's amazing. Just last night, our hockey team won their first state tournament hockey game. We have the girls' basketball team in the tournament this upcoming Friday. We have 32 Japanese students coming to visit our school tomorrow. From a school just north of Tokyo.
Wow.
And when we put the email out to students, if anybody wanted to help shadow, we had over 60 kids being willing just to help out. And it just shows the culture that we're trying to create at the high school.
Yep.
We have an upcoming play next weekend that we're excited about. So that's certainly what I'm most proud of in general. But in terms of some of the things that we've been trying to do at the high school, at least in my last few years in the role as principal, we really try to focus on the social, emotional health and well-being of our students. And that's been a school goal for ours for the last 4 years. And we've been trying to do different things from homework-free weekends to Hiller Days, which is starting school a little bit later on Fridays to let kids sleep in a little bit. instituting junior privileges. So when a junior has a free period first or last, they can either sleep in or go home early. We try to play music on Fridays in between classes. All little things that by themselves might not seem like a big deal, but altogether it's trying to focus on helping students find the balance. Mm-hmm. And I think that right now that is so critical.
So it also communicates a deep level of trust and respect for the students, and it helps them to make some decisions, right? So, you know, it is remarkable when you walk into the high school, and I think for those of us who are used to it, it's one thing. But when you come from a different community and you walk in for the first time, there's this sense of just peacefulness, happiness. That even though we talk about stress, there doesn't feel like there's a lot of tension. And it very much feels like a college campus in terms of kids having choice. And I think it's a wonderful opportunity for them perhaps to make some bad choices, you know, to...
Yeah, and then learn from them, right?
Right?
And,
like, go home and or maybe not make it back in time because they kind of didn't judge something properly and have the consequences. I know I asked you, I think, at a school committee member meeting recently about, well, how do they earn junior privilege to begin with?
Sure. Maybe you can answer that. There's some criteria. Yeah. Well, first and foremost, the parent has to be a supportive of it and sign off. But they have to have their grades at a certain level. They have to have no discipline referrals to the office. And overall, just being in good academic and social standing.
And
so we take that very seriously for both junior and senior privileges.
And so that's really motivating to be able to make those good choices. And while we're talking about social emotional learning, I think that really focusing on the whole child. So we know and we're proud of the fact that we're a high achieving district. But we also know that you get there by providing these kinds of supports for kids. And they can't be high achieving if they're stressed out or if they're not getting enough of the other things that they need. So I think those examples that you give us have really panned out to be really positive because we just keep getting better.
I like to think so. And we have over 40 clubs that kids get involved in. And we have a great athletic program. We have a great drama program. And just there's so much to get involved in.
What really strikes me is walking through the halls. So many, you know, posters and things going on in there that are clearly student driven. You know, they're passionate about something and they're looking for some interest or some support on something. And you were talking about the trying out different things. And you mentioned this on the last episode that there was some kind of survey that you had given to the student body, which I thought was really cool. That, you know, you're seeking out ideas and suggestions and you're trying out some of them.
I mean, that's the most important. We just talked about how students can make, you know, mistakes and they learn from it. And I certainly want to know how we're doing as an admin team and to try to get some feedback so we can make some changes and adjust our practice where we feel it's necessary. And so we try to send out a survey in the middle and the end of every year. And we'll ask about our school goals, how are we doing in regards to how people are feeling in regards to stress. And we ask about different things that we've done, tweaks that we've made to the schedule, or just overall different initiatives that we're taking on, and trying to get the students' feedback. And then we also ask them, you know, what can we do better? What can we add to the school? What do we not have that we could maybe bring on? And so it's something that we take very seriously. The kids, we had over, I think, almost 700 kids responded to the most recent survey, which
was
a good amount.
That's well over half.
Well over half. So it was like really great feedback. And so we've from that already, we have brought back music. We used to have music in between classes on Friday and kind of went away from it, and then kids really wanted it back. So it was just one small thing. Also, we have suggestion boxes in our guidance and library. So for students that you know, might not feel comfortable coming to the office or have something they want to bring to our attention, they could put it in the suggestion box. We'll read it, and then we'll bring it in front of our school council that meets every other month. So,
so lots of ways of having a voice.
Lots of ways to have a voice. I think that's very important to us, both for students and staff, to have a voice in the decision-making process.
Well, you know, for every school, we always send our main man, producer, Mike, to go into school and kind of do a day in the life.
Is it time?
And I think that we should kind of transition to that.
Great.
And kind of take a look at what's going on in the school.
Let's do it.
In full voice, all at the same time. But I mean, I'm loud. This is how loud you want me.
Was proclaiming
or no?
Oui, como se dice. fulfill that dream.
Think why this looks like a good model for a factory. I know you last year learned a little bit about industrialization. So again, what makes this work, do you think, for a factory?
Most people know about these theories, but they really fit into school.
Whoever could find out a fair, cheap, and easy method of making these children sound useful members of the Commonwealth would deserve so well of the public as to have a set, as to have a statue of the preserve. He wants a statue.
That's right. Don't you think? I mean, if we had somebody in our society that could solve poverty, I think they would deserve more money.
So welcome back. Wasn't that great to see everything that goes on in a typical day? It's really amazing about all of the variety of things that kids have access to in a day. And, you know, so we just thought that maybe you could speak to us a little bit about what we just saw.
Sure. Yeah. We tried to kind of get a snapshot of what a typical day would be like for a student. Kind of the hustle and bustle. You start the video when you're kind of passing between classes. We touched upon different levels and different subjects, as you notice. We had anywhere from AP honors and college prep levels and all the different departments from our English and math, science, history, engineering, robotics, you saw. Also, we spent some time in the cafeteria, a little bit of downtime, which is so important for the students during lunchtime. We allow our students during their 25-minute lunch period, they can shoot hoops, they can play ping pong, kind of do a little bit of a de-stress before going back to class, which is also kind of, like I said before, part of our discussion around the social-emotional piece.
They can also eat in a variety of places.
Yeah. That's correct. Yeah, they can, absolutely. Especially when the weather's nice, they can go out in the back area as well, in the patio. But we let kids pretty much eat, you know, all around the school.
Yeah.
We trust them that they're going to clean up for themselves and, you know, wherever they're comfortable and can kind of get away and enjoy their time off, I think it's important. And another thing I wanted to mention, and a big thanks to the HEF, you saw some different furniture alignment in our library, which we're really excited about. It's a grant that we got this past year, and it's been kids have been very excited about it. It reminds you of a college campus center in a lot of ways. Some high top tables, really new, brand new projector where we have teachers come in and teach lessons and bring the group into the library. It's really the center of the school, in my opinion, that area by the school store, guidance, and the library. And that's where a lot of the energy is.
I love those tables outside the library just for like socializing and getting caught up on things.
That's become kind of like the real cool spot to either eat your lunch or just be, and we try to do our best of being in there between classes to kind of see the kids and say hi to them each and every day between classes. And so, it's a nice environment.
Have you seen a difference in the numbers of kids accessing the library?
Yeah, I feel it's a higher traffic area now. There's more kids going into the library. Not that there wasn't before.
Mm-hmm.
There just seems to be a little bit more of an energy of wanting to be in the library on a period-to-period basis, mm-hmm. particularly during the lunch period. It's really exciting.
I know the school committee wanted to be in there as soon as they saw it.
Yes,
we do kind of joke about the fact that those comfy chairs have people staying longer to our meetings. So
I remember one of the members was like, we should use these chairs that have the little desk.
Right. Yeah.
Not only does it look really cool, but also have that maker space too. I think that's pretty awesome.
We do, yeah. That's was brought in about 2 years ago by our librarian, Miss Kirsten Fournier, who's just been a wonderful addition to the high school. It's kind of tucked around in the back corner of the library where kids can really make things and produce things. And she has a club after school, and students are there quite a bit. We're trying to bring staff down there to see the makerspace. So you have the makerspace, you have the newer furniture. It's really just a nice environment there.
Yeah.
And I think it gives, like I said earlier, that kind of feel, that learning commons feel, where there's group work, there's collaboration, there's people coming together on projects, and it's a nice place. And speaking of kind of projects within the library, this past week we had our annual science fair at the
high school. Goodness.
Yeah, and it was outstanding. We had 28 projects and 38 students total working on the science fair this year. I do need to give a plug to our team of science teachers, Ms. Lachansky, Ms. Baldiger, Ms. Shire, and Ms. Noblet, along with Ms. Grilly, who work so hard as mentors for these students. We have seen a dramatic increase in the amount of students getting involved in science fair over the last 3 or 4 years, which is exciting. But the quality of project this year was just
amazing.
Outstanding.
Well, you know what? A picture's worth a thousand words. And HCAM's news director actually happened to be there and took some footage of it. So why don't we show the viewers a little bit of what it was like there?
That's awesome. Let's do it.
Hi, my name is Freya Proudman, and I did my study on young women's optimisms for their futures.
So for our project, we did the durability of long-lasting lipstick.
So I'm Abby Kelly Lancer, and I did my science fair project on music and language. I wanted to find the relationship between the two.
What I've done here is I've done a study of earthworm regeneration. I was studying not what could be regenerated, because that's already been well studied. What I was studying was how the regeneration process affects worms themselves.
Hi, my name is Hertesh, and today I'm going to be talking to you about my project. It's on biofuels. So sooner or later, our world is going to run out of fossil fuels, and we need to find something that can replace them so we can produce our electricity.
So my project this year revolved around trying to create an automatic hand washing machine.
I've been here now for 11 years. I've seen 11 different science fairs, and I think this might be, as a collective group, the best one that I've seen.
No particular order. The first person that is going to regionals is Ashley Nee with the Association of Smell and Memory Impairments. This project is a group project with Parima Sharma and Bronwyn Pappas Byers, development of solar cells using conductive glass. Okay, the next project is for Will Lambert, distracted driver detector using webcam. Elon Rosen using a directional lighting network to aid in fire escape. Okay, the next person is Maria Tartaglioni, the effect of ocean acidification on American lobsters. Thank you for that. The next project goes to Hertesh Rajanagan, which biofuel is best. Okay, the next group going to regionals is Alexa Binock, Sarah Cahill, and Eva Curavilla, finding effective biodegradable alternatives to plastic. The next person going to regionals is A. Neen, harvesting piezoelectricity for everyday use. So we have a tie for third place. So the first third place project is going to go to Freya Proudman, Young Women's Optimism for Our Future. The other third place project is going to go to Kate and Emma for the effect of global warming on spider silk protein. All right, in second place, this project goes to Brian Best, Music Math, as music follows Zipfian distribution. First place project this year goes to Himanshu Minosha, campus safety warning and notification.
So I had the pleasure of attending and the opportunity to speak with some students. And one of the things I learned was that this is something that they do in addition to their regular coursework.
That's true, yeah. So they take this on, like you said, in addition. They are assigned, like I said before, a mentor. And these projects pick up typically in October, and they run through now to February. And oftentimes they're putting in 5-6 hours additional time after school per week for these projects, which just shows their commitment level.
Absolutely. Yeah. So it operates kind of like a club.
It does in a lot of ways. Yep. So they're organized with a mentor. They meet with them after school or during the school day if their free periods align. And they work together over the course of 4 or 5 months with trial and error and the different things that come along with the project. And
Well, something else of note that really struck me, and I think that this is a really great example about how cross-content support the kids are getting, is their presentation skills.
Yeah.
The confidence, how well-spoken they were, the eye contact, all of those things that I know are also skills that are taught to the kids, but it was really very, very impressive. Every student I had the pleasure of speaking with was just able to present their topics so well.
Yeah, that struck me as well. Being this my 12th year, I've been to a lot of science fairs, and I felt this year, just as a collection of projects with not only the topics, but the way the kids could communicate them at a high level, was one of the best that I've seen.
Yeah, well, congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah.
We're looking forward to recognizing them at the March the 16th school committee meeting. So school committee always loves that.
And actually, and wasn't there a kid who been doing some interesting things, like getting a patent or something like that?
Yeah, so one of our students, Himanshu, now has filed for 2 patents.
Okay.
One from a project last year, and then this one most recently is around an app around campus safety and security. And it was very fascinating. And so he's a very talented, unique, hardworking young man.
Yeah.
And he's going to be very successful.
And you know, my story from that is, the other day, about a month or so ago, WPI's president was being interviewed on NPR and talked about how cool their students were, and was mentioning the story of a girl who got a patent for a device, which I happen to know she did at Hopkinton High School.
That's right, that's correct.
Well, there you go.
Yep.
So that brings us back to you,
yes,
Mr. Bishop, because I think people at home might be curious to know, what is it about being a high school principal that is the most challenging? And you, especially being in all of the different roles that you have been in, what is it about being at that position, the principal, that you would say is the most challenging?
Sure, yeah. I joked in our last episode of HHS Today that it's making sure I communicate to people that I'm not the one who makes the snow day call.
Okay.
So challenging, but in all seriousness, it's an all-encompassing position. And you're trying to do quite a bit for quite a few stakeholders, and you know, my number one stakeholders, I guess, would be my family and my 4-year-old girls, and so it's very important that I spend quite a bit of time with them. But on a given week, with all the things that we have going on after school and getting to them, I try to go to as many athletic events as I can. I try to go to as many clubs. I try to go to as many plays. I try to go to everything that's going on at the school. And it can be challenging trying to find that balance. And so I try to talk to the kids about it and talk to the staff about it. But finding that healthy balance, and I think the most challenging part for me is me myself trying to find that.
Right, because you know how much it means when you show up.
Yes.
But I think 2 things I've noticed. One is that sometimes when you have the opportunity, you bring those darling girls.
I do sometimes.
I've seen them at shows. I've seen them at games, and it's been fun watching them grow up.
Yep.
You know, grow up now that they're all of 4.
Well,
but I have seen them there when they were 2. And then you do have a wonderful administrative team.
Yeah, it's
that
it's a great team.
You know, you share, you divide and conquer, and try to divide up who's going to be at what event.
We do. I can't speak highly enough about the admin team that we have. And I've been, like I said, been here for quite a bit of time, and I've had been part of different teams. And every team has their uniqueness and pros, but this group that I'm with Mr. Pominville, Mr. Hanna, and Ms. King is the best group that I've been a part of. And just such dedicated, hardworking people who care so much about kids.
Yeah.
They all have young families. And it's... they're so passionate about what we're trying to do at the school. And, you know, in the surveys that we send out, we always get back feedback, particularly around the assistant principals, about how much the kids respect them and how much they enjoy talking to them and how much they're visible and approachable, which just speaks volumes to just the type of people that they are. And I'm very, very grateful to have them as part of our
team. Know, that sincerity comes across big time. And I think that, you know, the traditional model of the assistant principal being the disciplinarian, you know, and oh my goodness, you don't want to have to go there. You know, you've worked hard to reverse that. And yes, that is part of the role, but it's also one of problem solving and helping kids to make better choices and healthier choices and learning from their mistakes.
Absolutely.
All of those things is the spirit that I always feel whenever I'm in the high school.
That's nice. That's nice to
hear. Do you find a lot of intimidation? Like, are the kids intimidated? No, seriously, is it intimidated to come and approach you?
I don't think so. I hope not.
Yeah.
Maybe my height, I guess. I don't think so. Yeah, I don't think so. We try to create that. We try to be out in the hallways as much as possible. We try to say hello to as many kids as possible. Mm-hmm. I think part of sending out those surveys is to show that we are real. We try to be at things. And so I think that all kind of is a package when I don't think kids are intimidated to come to us.
Okay. Good.
So something else that's been something I wanted to talk about that's been happening over the past several weeks, working with Tamaria, who has started a diversity website in town. She's new to town. She's reminded us last night that I think she's been here for 14 months.
Yes, sir.
Moved here from New Jersey. And Denise Hildreth, to really look at how can we address community concerns, but in a joint kind of fashion. So last night we kicked it off with what we called a community conversation. It was very well attended. There were 25 people there. What I had thought would be, you know, introductions and then, you know, getting into setting some goals for our work together, ended up being 2 hours of just listening to each other's story. Mm-hmm. And it was really powerful. People really wanted to get to know each other. Mr. Bishop was there. There were several teachers there. Mrs. DeBow was also there, so we had elementary and secondary principal leadership. Just parents from across the district, faith leaders from across the district. And it was a very powerful beginning step, I believe, to working within this community to take, you know, leadership in common problem solving and mutual respect. And that was what came out of it, was just this building of respect, and really, as Valerie Van Rosenberg pointed out to the group, understanding people's stories as people, mm-hmm. and not just as a newspaper article. And so I'm excited about that beginning last night. I want to thank, as I did last night, everybody who came out, because we feel Hopkinton can really set an example for other communities in terms of how we can work together and really create some very strong bonds within a community that's quickly changing and becoming, we are pleased to know, more diverse.
Right, right.
So I wanted to talk about, kind of finish our program by highlighting that highlight on
the button. Yeah, that's excellent. That's a really good point. In fact, we're pretty much out of time here. So.
Okay.
So, Mr. Bishop, thank you very much for coming and being on our show.
Yeah, thank you for having me. This is a lot of fun.
And that's our show. We'll see you next time at our next episode of Highlights from the Hill.